This video is on Prim's minimum spanning tree algorithm, discovered by Jarnik in 1930. A few other people discovered it too. To understand it, you should know what graphs are and how they're represented, and you should know some kind of priority queue. Most importantly, this video relies on the introduction to spanning trees video. They're like a single video with an intermission, and intermission's over. Like our other algorithms, we start with a forest of single vertex trees for every vertex in the graph. But unlike Kruskal and Berufka, there's one special vertex from that forest. Let's say vertex A. A's tree is special for this algorithm. We will repeatedly find the minimum edge weight leaving it and add it to our forest. It doesn't look so much like a bunch of different trees in the forest merging. It looks like a single tree growing to take over the rest of the graph, assimilating it like the Borg would. It still fits our generic algorithm mold, but all of the trees in the forest except one are singleton vertices. That's Prim's general outline. Step by step, we'll replace the outline with the algorithm. We want to efficiently track the minimum weight edge from the special tree. That edge must lead to one of the vertices not yet in the tree. For each vertex not in the tree, store its minimum weight edge from the special tree as a potential minimum spanning tree. We put those edges into a priority queue, with the key for each vertex being the weight of the edge from our special tree to reach that vertex. Add initialization into the outline, where everything gets initialized with an infinite key except our special vertex gets zero. That will be the first vertex out of the queue. In the example, when I remove a vertex from the queue, I'll mark it orange. We have to consider that current orange vertex's edges to the other vertices still in the queue. For the first vertex, of course, any edge is better than nothing, so replace those dummy infinity edges with the edges from A and update the queue. Those fat blue edges, stored with the vertices still in the queue, should be thought of as potential minimum spanning tree edges. They haven't been ruled out yet. Once we're done with all edges from that vertex, we finish it and mark it blue. Right now, each vertex in the queue holds a potential minimum spanning tree edge, its minimum weight edge, reaching it from the special tree, which is just vertex A here. Whenever that's true, we can justify removing the vertex with the lightest edge from the queue and including its edge in the minimum spanning tree. That edge is the lightest edge crossing the cut between our special tree and the rest of the graph. By the cut-crossing theorem, it's in the minimum spanning tree. That's the way it works with every vertex after the first one. Before removing a vertex from the queue holds all vertices not yet in the tree, and each vertex holds its lightest weight edge to A's tree. One edge for each vertex except the first gives us V minus one edges total. Before that second vertex, G, the only edges in the queue are direct edges to A. Those are definitely the minimum weight edges from each queue vertex back to A's single vertex tree. G's edge grows A's tree, so we should update the lightest edges to all the vertices still in the queue. The lightest edge might still come from A, but now it could also come from G. We consider all edges out of the new vertex. If the edge leads to something already in the tree, ignore it. We've already looked at those edges from the other side. That's only the edge to A here. But for the edge from G to B, we could already reach vertex B for cost 17. That's better than 18. So we discard the 18 edge. We won't ever use it, and we won't ever have to change our mind about that. We can see that it's the maximum weight edge on a cycle. So by the cycle theorem, it definitely won't be in the minimum spanning tree. All of the other vertices that G has an edge to previously stored infinity values. So they all get new weights from their edge from G. And the priority queue gets updated after each change. Eventually, we finish with all edges from G. By checking all of the edges from that vertex, we've updated the edges from our tree to the vertices still in the queue. So each still holds its lightest edge to our growing tree, and collectively, they hold the lightest edge from that tree. Let's generalize those arguments. When we're ready to take another vertex from the queue, we assimilate it and the edge reaching it into our growing tree, which will always be a subtree of the minimum spanning tree. Because the queue held the lightest weight edges from our tree to the vertices in the queue, the lightest edge in the queue is definitely in the minimum spanning tree. So when we add it to our growing tree, we maintain that it is a subtree of the minimum spanning tree. The lightest edge from the updated tree to any vertex still in the queue either comes from the new vertex or from one of the vertices in the tree before it grew. We had already computed and stored those in the queue. Those are the only possibilities. We look at each edge incident on the new vertex. We can see a few possibilities for those edges when we get to vertex H. We can ignore any edge to a vertex already in A's tree. It is either the edge that we just added to the minimum spanning tree, or it's an edge we previously discarded. At all times, every edge is either known to be in the minimum spanning tree, discarded, in the queue, or we haven't seen it yet. Edges are seen first from whichever vertex is included into A's tree first, so edges to vertices already in the tree have been seen. For those edges, both vertices are already out of the queue, so we've already determined if those edges are in the minimum spanning tree or not. Ignore them. If the edge leads to a vertex still in the queue, check if it's a better way to connect that vertex to the tree. We compare the previous best way to reach it against the edge weight from our current vertex. Keep whichever is smaller and discard the other. H's edge gives a way to reach K when it couldn't be reached before, so that isn't a real edge we're throwing away. But what about when we take F from our queue and consider its weight 10 edge leading over to vertex K? We compare that against the weight 16 edge that was previously the best way to reach K from H, and we'll throw one of them away. Because F and H are now both in the growing tree, they are connected by edges in that tree, 15, 3, 6, and 2 here, and we know edges in that path are part of the minimum spanning tree. Taking that path plus the FK and HK edges gives a cycle. For sure, the heaviest edge on that cycle isn't in the minimum spanning tree by the cycle theorem. The heaviest edge can't be any of the edges on the tree path from F to H because we've used the cut crossing theorem to show those are in the minimum spanning tree. So it has to be one of the last two edges. That justifies discarding the heavier of those two edges forever. It's the heaviest in a cycle. You might notice that this looks a lot like Dijkstra's single source shortest paths code, but that really has an actual special vertex, the source. Here, we don't really need to even mark a special vertex. We could have left its weight at infinity. Whatever arbitrary infinity weight vertex the priority queue spits out first would be your special vertex. It's not that special. Anyway, with such similar code, it isn't surprising that the analysis is similar. The algorithm takes linear time, excluding the priority queue operations. V extractions empty the queue, and up to once for each edge, we might decrease the key of something in the queue. If you use a binary heap as a queue, that will give you E log V time. And if you use a Fibonacci heap, which takes constant average time to decrease a key and average logarithmic time to extract the minimum, it takes E plus V log V time. If the graph has at least V log V edges, that's linear runtime. Not even that queue can fight off the Borg. Resistance is futile.